Thank you. I'm very happy to be here. The architect and city planner Daniel Hudson Burnham is best known for his work with his early partner John W. Root on the development of the tall office building, for his work on the World's Columbian Exhibition of 1893, and for his city planning projects, especially his 1909 Plan of Chicago. This paper will focus on the Plan of Chicago and its relation to Burnham's Swedenborgian religious beliefs. Emanuel Swedenborg was an 18th century Swedish Lutheran scientist and mystic. He was called the Buddha of the North by D.T. Suzuki and by others the Leonardo da Vinci of his era. Although most people know little or nothing of Swedenborg today, he was well known in his own day and throughout the 19th century. His ideas influenced American artists Hiram Powers and George Innes, and John W. Root and Louis Sullivan, as well as Burnham. Swedenborg's early studies included chemistry and physics, mines and canals. His later investigations, however, were more esoteric as he sought the nature and location of the soul in the human body. Swedenborg believed that the physical form of the body originated in the soul. This idea of the spiritual origin giving form to the physical is an important theme in Swedenborg's writings and in this paper. His inquiries led to a spiritual reawakening and to subsequent mystical revelations that convinced him that all existing Christian churches were dead and in need of revitalization. Swedenborg believed that he delivered a message from God for a new interpretation of Scripture. This hermeneutical emphasis influenced Burnham's interpretation of his own professional work. Based on Swedenborg's extensive writings, his followers founded the Church of the New Jerusalem. Note the name, the New Jerusalem, the heavenly city of the second coming described in the book of Revelation. Let's recall Louis Sullivan's description of Burnham. Louis found Burnham a sentimentalist, a dreamer, a man of fixed determination and strong will, no doubt about that, a large, wholesome, effective presence, a shade pompous, a mystic, a Swedenborgian, a man who readily opened his heart if one were sympathetic. He liked men of heart as well as brains. He averred that romance need not die out, that there must still be joy to the soul in doing big things in a big personal way devoid of the sordid. Yet it is also Sullivan who reminds us of the other side of Burnham, of the architect who, from the outset of his career, strove for big projects in emulation of the large business corporation. Sullivan observed that the only architect in Chicago to catch the significance of this movement was Daniel Burnham, for in its tendencies toward bigness, organization, delegation, and intense commercialism, he sensed the reciprocal workings of his own mind. The Burnham who emerges here is both practical and sentimental, shrewd and spiritual, a doer and a dreamer together, or as one colleague put it, Burnham was a visionary with sound business judgment. This duality is not unlike Swedenborg's own in mines, canals, chemistry, and physics, and mysticism. Swedenborgianism was the religion of Burnham's childhood. He thought of entering the ministry, but found his calling instead in architecture. In letters to his mother as a young man, Burnham verbalized the connection between his religion and his newly chosen profession. He described architecture as the striving after the beautiful and useful laws God has created to govern his material universe. He believed that his professional calling would open my mind more and more to the great architect of the universe. Burnham's commitment to his religious beliefs continued throughout his life. Some 40 years after the letters to his mother, we have evidence of this in the words of Burnham's protege, Edward H. Bennett. Bennett was co-author of the Plan of Chicago and worked closely with Burnham on the design of neighborhood park field houses. Bennett recalled that Burnham thought men were at their best when they channeled some higher force. He described Burnham as a blazing human spirit of pure gold, who flooded my life with its warmth and inspiring faith for years. Bennett noted after a visit to a then-hospitalized Burnham that we talked of Swedenborg, or rather I listened to him discourse on the subject and came away strengthened in purpose. To understand how Burnham's religious beliefs relate to his planning activities, two of Swedenborg's important concepts must be introduced: correspondence and uses. Swedenborg believed there was a correspondence, a meaningful connection between the various planes of being, that everything outward and visible has an inward and spiritual cause. He wrote, "The whole natural world corresponds to the spiritual world. It must be understood that the natural world springs from and has permanent existence from the spiritual world, precisely like an effect from its affecting cause. For example, both the spiritual and material realms have a sun at the center. The Lord is the sun in the spiritual world, radiating heat that is divine love and light that is divine wisdom. This corresponds to the sun in our natural world, whose emanations are merely physical." In the spiritual realm, Swedenborg identified three heavens: the innermost and most perfect, an intermediate, and an outermost. Beyond the outermost heaven is the world of spirits, and beyond that is hell with its three divisions. Please note the concentric configuration of that description. When the natural world corresponds to the divine order of the spiritual, it is able to manifest goodness. For Swedenborgians, the goal was to produce the highest, most noble representations of the spiritual that would elevate, refine, and purify the mind. According to Bennett, the laws of spiritual correspondence were often in Burnham's mind. Burnham wrote a sermon on the court of honor of the fair, explaining the correspondence of its design to the verses from the Revelation to John chapter 4. And Bennett recalled while they were working on the plan for San Francisco, he had seen Burnham trace the correspondence of spiritual powers and municipal powers as indicated in the physical layout. According to Bennett, Burnham believed in the infinite possibilities of the material expression of the spiritual, and that consciously or unconsciously, no great work can have been conceived without a sense of an underlying spiritual meaning. Now, on the right here is a redrawing of Eugène Aynard's Diagram of Paris. And this is a redrawing that Burnham had done and is included in the plan of Chicago. And we'll get back to Aynard in a minute. This is the plan of Chicago, and north in this case is to the right. In the plan of Chicago, we can expect to find a similar correspondence. The scholar Irving Fisher has argued that the divine order of heaven is represented in the plans of the city. Fisher developed his own diagrams to posit the limits of heaven, and these are Fisher's diagrams from his article. While I agree with the basic supposition, I disagree with the diagrams. Given the scale at which Burnham liked to work, and since Burnham himself offers what I would argue is his own diagram in the plan of Chicago, I see no need to create an alternative. So this is Fisher's inner, intermediate, and outer heavens. And then in another article, he combines them here. This is a little harder to see, but we have them here in one diagram. In the plan of Chicago, we see evidence that Burnham was looking for this divine configuration in history in the plans of some cities. Burnham used the diagrams of urbanist Eugène Aynard to illustrate this in the plan of Chicago. Especially in Paris, with its concentric rings, we see a conformation closely resembling Swedenborg's description of heaven. Burnham remarks in the plan, and these are his words, "The universal mind recognizes in Paris, that complete articulation which satisfies the craving for good order and symmetry in every part. Shortly after these Aynard diagrams in the plan of Chicago is this plate, depicting the concentric configuration with encircling roots and color variation, emphasizing the different territories. This plan, I would argue, represents not only the correspondence of the plan of Chicago, the concordance of the plan of Chicago with that of Paris, but also the correspondence of the new Chicago with the three heavens of Swedenborg's description. And in the plan and elsewhere, in the plan and elsewhere, I can find no other reason for the color variation in this plan. And it's the only one like it, and it immediately succeeds the Aynard diagrams. This is the inscription of divine order on Chicago. And when I say the scale at which Burnham liked to work, we see here his plan for the park systems. So we had been looking at just this area, and you can see how he continues the concentricity here, and then now orienting north to the top in the surrounding roads of the city. So that's correspondences. Uses. For Swedenborgians, uses is one's contribution to community. Uses could be the pursuit of one's work or career as long as the focus was not on individual gain. To be in uses through one's work, one would have to, and this comes from a little card that Burnham's wife carried around with her, one would have to discharge with fidelity the functions of one's employment and the duties of one's office, and to make oneself in all things useful to society. Swedenborg wrote, "By uses, not only the necessities of life are meant, but also the good of one's country, community, and fellow citizens. Business is such a good when it is the end love, and money is immediate subservient love, and when the businessman shuns and is adverse to fraud and bad practices." Swedenborg did not discourage success, but success had to be pursued in the right frame of mind, balanced by a sense of duty to community and neighbor. For Swedenborgians, all elements of faith and charity dwell in good work. And useful work is the simplest and most powerful method for personal spiritual growth. Swedenborg said simply and clearly, there is no happiness in life apart from activity, and Burnham agreed. In a letter to his wife Margaret, he wrote, "Work is the one thing that tells in this world, isn't it, dear? We both know the real good of it, do we not? Life, without it, life would be nothing." Burnham's city planning was his uses. Burnham would get no payment for his 3-year effort on the plan of Chicago. He did it as a service to the community. But it was not just Burnham's donation of his time. Burnham hoped that his city planning work would improve the lives of his fellow citizens. And from here out, these will be all images from the plan of Chicago, even though later I will be quoting not from the published plan, but from the manuscript draft of the plan. Burnham hoped that his city planning work would improve the lives of his fellow citizens. If we can see past the beauty of the rendered perspectives, we can hear Burnham's concern in the text. He declares, "The slum exists today because of the failure of the city to protect itself against gross evils and known perils. Chicago has not yet reached the points where it will be necessary for the municipality to provide at its own expense for the rehousing of persons, but unless the matter should be taken in hand at once, such a course will be required in common justice to men and women so degraded by long life in the slums that they have lost all power of caring for themselves." And here we have, you know, Magritte's image of, this is not a pipe. What do you believe, the image that you see or the text that says it's not? So here we're focusing on the lushness and beauty of the city typically shown in Burnham's renderings of the plan of Chicago. But when you read the text and when you read the draft, you're able to hear something else. However, in the published plan, we do see Burnham's concern in the few photographs of the neighborhood park field houses and the activities that they supported in the city's poorest neighborhoods. The manuscript draft of the plan argues more pervasively for Burnham's social concerns. This draft of roughly 300 pages was finished by 1908, and it includes a social agenda that was omitted from the final published version. Notable among the services that Burnham proposes in the draft is child care for working mothers. This is 1908. He sees it as urgently important and says, "It has intimately to do with the self-respect of great numbers of women, women who are willing to and do work and who cannot do it and take care of young children at the same time." Burnham argues that it is important to preserve the self-respect of these working citizens and help keep them from dependence because despair and hopelessness in the citizen is a danger to the public. Throughout the draft, Burnham maintains the relationship between the individual and the larger community is an essential one, and that improvements in the individual condition will result in improvements to the larger society. In the draft, Burnham developed his argument about the importance of school playgrounds and the opportunities they give teachers to observe the social development of their charges. Similarly, neighborhood parks could benefit both adults and children by providing a place which would bring not only the children and youth, but the adults out into the open. They conduce to association, discussion, good manners, and moderation on the part of all. In short, they have a profound effect on good citizenship. There cannot be too many of these neighborhood parks. The more there are, the safer and sounder our democracy will grow because they tend to cultivate those qualities which are the most important for a citizen to possess. Burnham argues that we are at our best when we are seen by others and that the safety of the community is enhanced by keeping the activities of the citizens open to the public gaze. Burnham applied this idea to the police force as well. He concerned himself in the draft with the redesign of police stations so that, quote, the policeman can do nothing to any prisoner while hidden from view. Here he argues it would be beneficial to good police service to open up the statements to observation because, he says, where men are hidden from public gaze, they do not exercise the same control over themselves as when their actions can be seen. Here, observation is intended to prevent the abuse of power by representatives of the state. By exposing all to public view, both the citizens and the authorities would be at their best in Burnham's city. Burnham envisioned a mutually advantageous relationship between the city and the citizen, a social ideal in which both society and the individual would benefit. Burnham's attitude can be summarized by his criticism of those who have made colossal fortunes as the result of undue advantage and who use it, he says, in ways that increase the inequalities of life instead of mitigating them. Why would Burnham want to mitigate the inequalities of life? Because of his Swedenborgian religious beliefs. City planning was his uses. The design of the neighborhood park field houses was his being in uses. It was Burnham's contribution to the creation of a physical realm so as better to correspond with that of the heavenly, not only in configuration, but in goodness. Frank Sewell, a Swedenborgian minister and friend, wrote in Burnham's obituary about a trip he took to Chicago. Oh, I have one page, if I may, please. When guiding his visiting friend around the city, Burnham showed the most pleasure when Sewell expressed his appreciation of the finely conceived park district playgrounds and assembly halls and of every provision for which had its aim the pleasure and the good of the whole citizenship, without any distinction between rich and poor. Sewall wrote that no one in his time but Burnham conceived on so large and grand a scale and in so main a human spirit of the function of the art of building as one of the great humanizing and edifying instrumentalities in human advancement. For Mr. Burnham was a builder of cities preeminently, and this in all the highest and spiritual meaning that can be attached to the term. The teachings of Swedenborg proffered a belief that if our surroundings exhibit spiritual order and manifest divine goodness, it will influence the world's inhabitants for the better. When people live according to the heavenly doctrine and the natural world more closely resembles the spiritual one, then the holy city, the New Jerusalem, will come to earth. Burnham endeavored to make this physical world more in accordance with that of the spiritual, both through uses and correspondence, by making himself useful and the world a better place. His professional work was a sacralizing of space, a way of bringing spiritual order to the socioeconomic free-for-all of early 20th century Chicago. In the overall good design of the city, he saw the material expression of the spiritual. For Burnham, his plan of Chicago, his noble logical diagram, was both a map of heaven and his map to get there. Thank you. Sorry for running over.